Right.
I last visited Dallas, Texas about 7 months ago in December 2022. You see, I was attending a conference. It was a small cohort of us. And on the second day during lunchtime, a black woman about my age asked me, "How do you deal with imposter syndrome?" I turned to her and said, "I don't. I don't identify with that." Now, she looked a little perplexed, as she presumed I, too, identify with imposter syndrome. I went on to say, whatever space or place that I show up in, I am supposed to be there. And when they denied me access, I made them give it to me. Later that night, when I went back to my hotel room, I thought about, well, really, why don't I identify with imposter syndrome? Now, I know that imposter syndrome is a core set of negative beliefs about oneself and one's self-value. And those are formed in your formative years, in your childhood. It's your life experiences, it's trauma, it's your religion, it's your family of origin, it's institutional racism, et cetera, et cetera. Now, I can say that I don't deal with imposter syndrome because I have radical confidence. You know, see, my radical confidence, it started when, in my formative years with my grandmother, you know, she was my secure attachment, and she gave me my voice. You know, she not only talked to me, but she listened to me. She gave me the space to make age-appropriate decisions, and it laid the foundation for my critical thinking process. Now, that's what fared well for me when I went on to pre-K, because I was going to have to advocate for myself to learn how to read. You see, I was exposed to books. But I realized, as I was observing during my school day, children, white children that is, being led to another space in the school. So one day I asked one of the little girls, my little white friend, I said, "Well, where are you going?" She says, "I'm learning how to read." I said, "I want to learn how to read too." So I went home and I told my grandmother, my mother, and my father. Now my grandmother was a little hesitant because it was the late 70s and racism was still racism, as racism is still racism today. Needless to say, my father, he went on to the school, and I was learning how to read. Now, this would open the door for my mother to have a conversation with me about whether I wanted to be Catholic or Baptist. See, now I was going to Catholic school for obvious reasons, and I was going through the First Communion with the other children, and I was growing up in the Baptist church, you know, attending all the functions during the week and on Sundays. So when my mother asked a question, I didn't give her an answer. But one particular Sunday, you see, I was attending children's church, and children's church let out 10 minutes before regular church. And so I came upstairs, and I sat with my mother and my grandmother. And when the altar call was given, I got up, and I walked to that altar. My mother would tell you the story that she reached to grab me. My grandmother said, "Let her go." Needless to say, I didn't know how this would impact my life in such a way, because I would leave my secure community in approximately about a year in Clarendon, Pennsylvania, which I'm proud of, and I would go to Long Beach, California with my mother, who was now a single mother, trying to pursue her dreams. However, but now I'm a latchkey kid, and I'm trying to navigate and figure out this world that's new to me and it's insecure and it's unfamiliar. So what do? I turn to books. Again, I love books. And I also watch after-school specials. That's how I learned too. I had a small core group of friends, but those books were my saving grace. You see, they opened up new things for me. New things were opportunities for me, not obstacles. And when I tried new things, the adults, they saw my gifts and my talents. And so they rewarded me. They gave me trophies, certificates, and other types of awards that I didn't even know I could accomplish or achieve. I was just being me. Now, my radical confidence will allow me to continue to grow as I was going through school. And then the apex of my confidence, I would say, at 18, when I went to my first Black Studies class. You see, I love literature, but I hadn't saw Black people in the past, in the present in that way. And so I knew I had a future. I also knew that I was a Black woman and that I was powerful. I would then go on in several years to rededicate my life to Christ. And when I rededicate my life to Christ, I was able to grab a hold of that scripture that said that God is no respecter of persons. So I knew that only God was the head of my life and that no one was better than me. So that would allow me to walk into rooms and know that I'm supposed to be there, that I'm able to go into rooms and be authentically me, and that I determine the rules of engagement in those spaces. Also, that oftentimes I'm called to speak the truth there. And so all of this would lay the foundation for me in my 30s to have a tough conversation with my mother. See, I had to explain to her, even though I had achieved so many things, there were so many things underlyingly that I had to work through because that drastic change in my environment. And so she was a little perplexed, but I gave her the understanding that my radical confidence is what got me through. So how does my radical confidence show up for me today? Well, I am comfortable with the uncomfortable. That I don't compare nor compete with others. And I create my own measure of success. It's not the social structure or keeping up with the Joneses. And I am different, and that is okay. Now, that's my story. What is your story? Now, you too can take an inventory and assessment of yourself where you are right now and make a decision that you want to make a shift in your mind towards radical confidence. How do you make that shift, you ask? Well, through a knowing and understanding and a belief about who you are, so you get to know and understand yourself better than anybody else. So only you define who you are and you define your destiny. Also, you need to have a heart connection, with your own heart, which will allow you to identify and receive and accept your own humanity. Because when you accept your own humanity, you can extend your grace to yourself in any situation. You see, we cannot rewrite our personal history, but we can redefine how it influences us. Because you, me, we are fearfully and wonderfully made by God, and we are marvelous in His sight.